Name? I'm Digveer Jais, Vice President Research and International at the University of Manitoba. Welcome to the Café Scientifique, or the cafes as we call in short. These cafes are the initiative of my office, and these were designed or formulated with the idea of bringing the researchers from the University of Manitoba to the public and in a comfortable setting. And Janine and Fred, who are the organizers of the event, always tell me the bookstore with the cookies and cheese and crackers is the most comfortable place. And I always say, no, bar is a more comfortable place. But, because there are two and I'm one, so I always lose the selection place. And we are thankful to McNally Robinson for hosting us, and they have been hosting us for many, many years, so we are thankful to for that. We have an exciting and very relevant topic of discussion for tonight's cafe. In the Pink, 50 Years of Breast Cancer Research. Tonight's experts will be sharing their research knowledge on this topic, and I'm sure you, our audience, will have much to contribute to the discussion tonight as well. I would like to introduce your moderator for this evening, who will tell you more about the panelists and some of the ground rules that would guide the discussion this evening. Dr. Afsin Raouf is a team leader at the Manitoba Cancer Research Group, associate professor of, in the Immunology Department and Regenerative Medicine Program at the University of Manitoba. Dr. Raouf is a senior scientist with the Research Institute on Oncology and Hematology, a joint institute of the Cancer Care Manitoba and the University of Manitoba. His research program seeks to identify primitive cell programs that regulate the normal function of the memory stem and progenitor cells, establish how the inappropriate execution of these programs causes the normal stem cells and progenitors to acquire a cancer stem cell phenotype, and determine whether this understanding can be leveraged to develop therapies against breast cancer stem cell populations. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Afsin Raouf.
Thank you, Dr. Jais, for that more than kind introduction. Welcome, everyone, to what promises to be one of the biggest snowstorms of the year so far. We had warnings from Cancer Care Manitoba, it's okay if you're late tomorrow. So I don't know if it doesn't snow, if it's still okay, but looks like I'll be late regardless. So with that, we'll start. So we appreciate you guys coming out tonight. As Dr. Jais mentioned, I'll moderate this, which typically means you ask questions, I point to answers, and then they do what I tell them. And then later I have to deal with that. We'll figure that part out later. So I think there are some ground rules, things that I'm supposed to tell you, you're supposed to do and not supposed to do. So number one is you probably noticed that we have cameras in the back. So not do's are photobombing and saying, hi mom, jump in front of that camera, those kind of things that do not do. Things to do is smile. That's always good. Okay, so this is just to let you know that this whole discussion night is being recorded, so you can see yourself on camera later on, and I think that's a good thing. I don't know, we'll see. So keep that in mind. Our panelists are going to talk about 5 to 7 minutes, and if they do more than that, I'll cut them off. And that is so that you have time to ask questions. And when you do, remember that this is more of a scientific discussion about where we have come the past 50 years, and where we're going from here on. And so refrain from asking specific questions about treatment options and drug therapies and things like that. Leave those for afterwards. And you know, our oncologist on panel Dr. Peets has promised he would stick around. We'll see if we can go over that. So your job is to make sure you will stick around. So keep those questions for afterwards. And the other, the biomedical researcher on this side, they kind of said, yeah, they'll stick around. So if you do want to ask questions, please do that. Let me see, I actually covered most of these things, isn't that cool? Okay. Oh yeah, if you see a drone flying around taking pictures and videos, swat at it, it's not ours. that's not for long term. We don't do drones. That wasn't on here. That was, I just thought I'll add that in. Drones are becoming popular. Okay, so we're going to have this session until 8:30. That's when I'll stop everything so you can ask questions afterwards. Oh, yes, I think you guys already knew that this stuff are for you to enjoy, and I didn't have to say it, so I'm glad I didn't have to say it. So now, with all of those ground rules, we are on to our panelists, and my job is to introduce you to these wonderful people that I have the pleasure of calling colleagues, and I see them every day, and we interact every day, which is wonderful. So, with that, on that side, we have Dr. Marshall Peetz. He's a medical oncologist and head of clinical research at Research Institute of Oncology and Hematology, which is a joint institute of Cancer Care Manitoba and University of Manitoba. You're going to hear me say that a lot because we all share the same affiliation. He is an associate professor of medicine in the faculty, in the Rady Faculty of Health Sciences at the University of Manitoba as well. In his spare time, he's a medical oncologist, which entails breast cancer and brain tumors alike. And he has a great deal of expertise in clinical epidemiological studies, translational research methods. So ask about all of those things. He actually recently had a very nice paper describing the landscape of breast cancer in Manitoba as compared to the rest of the country. So that's a good topic for discussion. He's interested in new drug developments, and he sits on investigational new drug committee at the Canadian Cancer Trials Group. So he has a knowledge about clinical trials that are going on as well. Next to him, we have Dr. Stephen Pistorius, a real-life physicist. So all of those math questions, you know, those equations you looked at and you said, what? He likes those. He likes those. And he's going to, so your job is to ask him to show you those equations. I think he brought them with him. He's going to go over them one by one. He's going to make you solve for x and, maybe not, I hope not. He promised he won't talk about equations tonight, so we'll hold on to that. He is a research scientist with the Cancer Care Manitoba at the Research Institute of Oncology and Hematology. He's also a professor of physics and astronomy, so you can ask him about those neutrino stars that just collided and created gold in the universe. That I found interesting. Astronomy at the Faculty of Sciences, an associate professor of radiology, and director of medical physics graduate program, and vice director of the biomedical engineering graduate program at the University of Manitoba. In his spare time, he does research. He is the current president of the Canadian Association of Physicists. Is that like Sheldon Cooper? Okay, so we'll give that a pass then. So I can't call him Sheldon. Okay. His research interests cover the modeling and simulation of radiation transport and its application to medical imaging and radiation therapy. So a lot of mammography-related and other imaging system for breast tumor diagnosis and early diagnosis, so you can ask him about those things. Dr. Pistorius' research has three main areas of focus: scatter imaging for improving quality and reducing radiation dose, which is always good, microwave imaging with particular focus on breast imaging, and use of diagnostic and mega voltage imaging for adapting, optimizing, and verifying radiation therapy. Ask him what those stuff means. It's just went outside my area of expertise. And next to him, we have Dr. Sabine Humbach-Polish. That's the other Sabine I know. And both of them are German. Sorry, I apologize for that. I hope I got the rest of the name right. Humbach-Polish. Okay. Is an associate professor, section head, gross anatomy, department of human anatomy and cell science at the University of Manitoba, member of Manitoba Breast Cancer Research Group, and a member of Brain Tumor Research Alliance of Manitoba. So she wears two or three hats. Dr. Humbach has a medical training background and teaches anatomy to medical students and students of other health professions. In her research, Dr. Klonisch, or Humbach-Klonisch, is working to identify the molecular determinants and, as he goes on to the next, mechanisms within local tumor environment that regulate cancer cell invasiveness, survival, and chemo resistance in breast and brain tumors. So she's interested in how breast tumors basically end up in bone and lungs and other parts of the body which become really bad news. With that said, you've heard enough of me. You didn't come here to hear me babble on and on. I'm going to turn the microphone, mine off, and I'm going to have Dr. Keats on. He is on, so he's going to tell you about his research and what he thinks the past 15 years of research have taught us.
Thank you. So I just wanted to first say thank you very much for the opportunity to speak tonight. It's a pleasure to be able to talk to you all. So, as Afshin mentioned, I'm a medical oncologist and I have a deep breast cancer practice. I wanted to start off by saying that breast cancer really is certainly one of the most common cancers in the world, and that really there have been tremendous gains in the treatment of that cancer over the last many years. It goes back more than 50 years, but certainly many new developments and new treatments have been developed in the last 50 years. One in eight women will be diagnosed with breast cancer in their lifetime, and so that's a shocking number. In Manitoba alone, there will be about 900 per year now. Even just a few years ago, it was around 800. So it's unfortunately growing, mostly with the aging population. So a big risk factor for breast cancer is growing older, and as the population grows older, we expect more cases. So breast cancer is very common and causes obviously lots of trouble. The way that we approach it is typically based on obviously trying to diagnose it as early as possible, and then talk about various treatments with our patients. The way that we really approach that is based on looking at risk and what risk a patient really faces once they're diagnosed. And that's really where I wanted to focus my part of the talk. But essentially what we do is patients, when by the time they get to see me, have gone through a lot of their journey already. They've had a lump or some abnormality detected, and it's been worked up to the point that we know that it's a breast cancer. And then when they get to see me, it's typically because there's enough risk that we should be talking about some more aggressive treatments. And I treat a lot of women with chemotherapy as an example that I'm sure is familiar to everyone. So we've known now for many years, about 40 years, that chemotherapy for breast cancer saves lives. And the original publication was from the mid-1970s that showed that using now chemotherapy that we don't really use anymore, but is still effective, of course, called CMF, was beneficial in preventing cancer from coming back in women who had breast cancer already spread to their lymph nodes. And that was before we did a lot of testing for what the breast cancer is made up of. And I'll elaborate on that in a little bit. But suffice it to say that in the 70s or 80s, many women were treated with CMF chemotherapy when their breast cancer had spread to a lymph node. And then in the 80s, we started to use anthracyclines, which is a class of chemotherapies, not very selective, but certainly very potent, and we still use a lot of them today for some of the higher risk breast cancers. And then in the late 90s and 2000s, we started to use a new class called taxanes, and further improvements in survival with use of that. And then subsequent to that, we started to add on so-called targeted therapies, where a good example would be antibody treatments towards the HER2 protein. So HER2 is found on about 20% of breast cancer, 20% of breast cancers, and when there's a lot of it around, it really helps the cancer to grow, and it really drives that growth. So through research that's been done really over the last 20 years, we know that using medications that block that HER2 pathway. We have many now. The prototype was Herceptin, trastuzumab. In addition to all the other therapies, is extremely beneficial. So I've started to wade into how we further subtype breast cancers, and really that's of course based on a lot of research that spans well over 100 years, actually. So as many of you will know, estrogen is a hormone that's in every one of us. Much higher concentrations in women, and a lot of breast cancers are driven by estrogens. About 80% of them are driven by estrogens. And so over many years now, we've developed therapies. Therapies have been developed targeting that pathway to block estrogens one way or another. And so back 100 years ago, they were removing ovaries in women. And over the decades, new medications have been used, tamoxifen being probably one of the better prototypes that we still use today, very effective at blocking that estrogen pathway. So when I see a patient, we typically look at a number of things. We look at how far the breast cancer may have spread to lymph nodes or other parts of the body, and we look at its size and how aggressive it looks under the microscope, and then we also look at those special subtypes, those special things like the hormone receptors that I mentioned and the HER2 protein. Those still play a really critical role, really day-to-day for my patients and I. There are a number of other ways to classify breast cancer, and it just speaks to the diversity. Breast cancer is not one disease, it's many, many diseases, and we're learning so much about it by studying it in more detail. And so that's really how we approach it. The work that I do partly is investigating new treatments in women, and so we have a number of clinical trials open and available for women with breast cancer to be enrolled on, and do our best to maintain that so that we always have new clinical trials and new treatments available. So that's a big part of my practice, and we're also looking at, because we know that we've been making significant improvements in survival, we want to help those that have gone through treatment for not leaving them as with so many side effects, so many long-term consequences of that treatment. And so some of the work that I'm doing is looking at different ways to reduce neuropathy, which is numbness and tingling and loss of sensation, and can be much more disabling than that, unfortunately, but very painful changes that occur with the use of these chemotherapy drugs that I use. And so that's one of the areas that I'm also researching. The work that we do as a group, you'll hear a lot more about a lot of the work that's happening. Part of my role at Cancer Care and within the Research Institute is to help the researchers on the clinical side, so looking at the direct impacts of patients. And so that spans a pretty wide gamut, as I mentioned, the investigational drugs, for example, but also to how someone's coping with the cancer, how at various stages, how they're going through the system, how they're actually making their way through the cancer system to get diagnosed and treated, trying to make sure that that's efficient. So we have a large group of people that are working to make things better here. And I think I'll leave you with maybe one last statistic. The Canadian cancer statistics are published every year, and the most recent one from this year said that since 1986, they estimate that around 32,000 lives have been saved with women diagnosed with breast cancer alone. And that's through the advances in research, in early detection, and in better treatment. And so it's a substantial number, especially when you consider the number that are diagnosed, and that's just Canada. So when you multiply that over the rest of the world, it's a very, very big number. And that's just in the last, I guess, 30 years. So anyways, with that, I'll pass it along and happy to answer questions.
Thank you very much for being here. medical physics and the history behind mammography goes back, well, for us over 120 years, back to Röntgen's discovery of X-rays, and everything that we've done with respect to mammography is built on that. So shortly after the discovery in 1895, they'd already started using X-rays, or looking at using X-rays to detect breast cancers. They were doing this by looking at mastectomies and doing it on those samples of tissue to see whether they could detect breast cancer. And so things evolved from there. In about 1946, they had already discovered or determined that the woman's least favorite aspect of mammography, that's breast compression, was necessary to try to get decent images. And those initial X-ray systems that were used up until about the 1960s were just routine X-ray systems that they were using to try to detect breast cancer. But they became aware relatively quickly that that wasn't giving them the best images. And so in the early 60s, we started to see dedicated mammograms being developed, which were specially designed, low energies, specially designed targets. This is the device that actually generates the X-rays from the accelerated electrons, and I won't go there, but generates the X-rays, specialized detectors that were able to detect the small changes that we're looking for much more accurately and precisely than we could see in regular chest X-rays, for example. And then over the 70s and 80s, we continued to see ongoing developments of mammography, continuing lowering the dose, which is one of the things I'll talk about in a moment. And by about the 2000s, dawn of the new century, we were starting to see three-dimensional systems being developed, breast tomosynthesis, and even full 3D CT systems, which have overcome some of the challenges that we face with regular mammography, which is overlying tissues. Whenever we take a regular mammogram, the tissues are sort of compressed, but one layer of tissue overlies the other. And we are trying to identify very small lesions and sometimes calcifications in the breast, and this structural noise is sometimes a challenge for us. And so these 3D systems allow us to get around that, but unfortunately they come at the expense of increased dose. So I think the first thing to say is that we know that early detection and appropriate treatments do save lives. And this is particularly apparent if you start to look at the worldwide statistics, where in developed countries, roughly 1 in 1,000 women will be diagnosed with having a breast tumor every year. And unfortunately fortunately, in the developing parts of the world, it's a lot lower than that. It's probably about a fifth of that. However, because they they don't have access to early detection and appropriate treatments, their mortality rates are about 50% higher than in the developed countries, and they bear the burden of about 56% of the total deaths associated with breast cancer in the world. This is in spite of having a lower incidence rate. And that can be primarily driven by, obviously, a lack of healthcare in general, but more specifically a lack of access to early detection and breast screening. So I think that's important that we recognize that there are benefits to having early detection and mammography in general. And mammography is probably our most affordable and easily accessible tool for doing breast cancer detection. However, no imaging system or detection system is perfect. And this is true of mammography as well. What are some of the challenges? Well, one of the major challenges is a large number of false positives. So typically about 10% of the women who will be screened, if you have 1,000 women, about 100 of them will have to be recalled for some additional examination because of a potential false positive. About 10 of those will have to go for a biopsy to detect one person out of that 1,000 that actually has a true positive of breast cancer. And so there's lots of anxiety and potential risk associated with those examinations and tests. So the other thing is we may end up overdiagnosing, where we're actually treating something that's been detected as a breast cancer, but that may in fact not cause harm to the woman in the long run if it was left untreated. And unfortunately, any additional treatment does bring with it its own risks and challenges. We also have risks from radiation dose. Now, our radiation doses, as I mentioned earlier, have been lowered quite substantially over the last number of years, and it's pretty small at the moment. But any radiation dose is accumulative. And so if we have an asymptomatic woman who's being screened regularly over a number of years, the risks associated with creating a cancer from that radiation will start to increase. And so we typically do not advocate screening for younger women. Younger women with denser breasts typically have higher doses, and obviously when they're younger, we're going to see a larger accumulated dose over their lifetime. False negatives are another challenge. We will typically miss about 20% of cancer, so one in five cancers will be missed. And as a result, that you know may cause some challenges. Although luckily enough, in the developed world, even those women who have not had that cancer detected by mammogram typically will have a five-year survival following treatment, which may be an argument for the advocates who say that mammography is not important, because they can show in many cases that these women will survive as long as women who have had mammograms. There are obviously concerns about perceived or real risks that may be occurring with mammography, and that may discourage women from being screened. And certainly in the developing countries, cost and access is a major problem. This is largely because mammographic systems require well-trained personnel to carry out the procedure. So while there are real benefits associated with mammography, there are also very real risks. And unfortunately, it's very difficult sometimes to try to find out what the real balance of this is. And this is because in many cases, we have to use mathematical or statistical models to try to understand what's actually occurring. So no woman who has been tested negative for breast cancer, for example, is going to opt for a mammography so that we can check to see whether there's actually a mastectomy, so that we can check to see if there's cancer there or not. So some of these things are unknown, and so we can only sort of estimate what the true risks of these procedures or not doing these procedures are actually going to be. So I think at the end of the day we can make the case that while there are real benefits associated with mammography, in some cases these benefits have been exaggerated, and in many cases the risks associated with mammography have been downplayed. This doesn't mean that anybody should not have a mammogram, or that I'm encouraging that you shouldn't. In fact, it's really a much more personal decision, and you have to weigh up from a personal perspective the risks and benefits associated with this. So at the end of the day, really the main response to this problem that we have in terms of trying to understand the risks and benefits is we need to do more research to create a better test, one that reduces the risks and increases the benefits. How are we doing this? Well, we have two major approaches. You heard earlier I have three areas of research. Two of them are appropriate for tonight's discussion. The first one is that of scatter imaging. Anytime an X-ray or a gamma ray interacts with tissue, it scatters. Unfortunately, these scattered photons have historically been considered to be noise which don't carry any useful information, but they do contribute to radiation dose. And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to find new techniques which use, yes, somewhat sophisticated mathematical and physical equations to describe the scattering process, to actually use these scattered photons to improve our image quality and to reduce the dose, and sometimes even to find other characteristics of the breast tissue that will allow us to improve the diagnosis, and specifically to improve our ability to identify more accurately whether this is a benign or malignant lesion. The other area of research is using microwave imaging. Microwave imaging uses relatively safe non-ionizing radiation to examine the breast. It uses a radar technique, and everything that we need is in our cell phone. So what we do is we have a set of antennas which are placed around the breast. We put a pulse of radiation into the breast from these antennas, and we wait for the response to come back. Tumors reflect more aggressively than do normal tissues, and so we see a heightened response when there's a tumor present. And by knowing how long it takes for that response to get back to the antenna, we can know where this is. And by doing this from a number of different angles, allows us to map out exactly where the tumor resists. And so this is a safer, more robust technique that doesn't require highly trained personnel to actually make use of it. In fact, our system is designed to allow the user to actually manipulate the system themselves. And we've sort of exposed people to this idea, both in Nigeria and in South Africa, to try to get a sense of whether this is something that they would be able to do. And we've had some very positive responses. So what we have, as I said earlier, is everything we need is in here. And so our vision ultimately would be to create some form of cell phone app. Perhaps not quite a cell phone app, but something similar that would allow us to detect breast cancer. Now, we're some way away from that, but much like the development of cell phones, those of you who've been around long enough would know, when they first arrived, they were extremely large, ran off a car battery, you know, ran for about 20 minutes, weighed a ton, and we're somewhat there at the moment. Our systems are large and cumbersome. Yes, we can fit them into a large suitcase, but they're getting smaller. And so our hope ultimately is to continue to work on our system, to reduce its size, improve the sensitivity and specificity of the system, and make it available to allow people in developing countries and even in remote locations within the developed world to have easier access to early detection of breast cancer. Really, at the end of the day, the bottom line is there are risks and benefits to any imaging modality. You know, our research, with the help of the Cancer Care Manitoba Foundation, is making strides in trying to improve on you know, the benefits and reduce the risks. Thank you for your time.
I have to say it's an honor for me to be here and explain what biomedical researchers are doing, because sometimes that's not so easy for you to understand. And I'm welcoming all the questions afterwards. And I'm very happy to represent you the group of breast cancer researchers that, as Afshin already introduced us, is researchers of the University of Manitoba, researchers in cancer care. And we are coming together with clinicians, and we are really trying to work together and understand the problem. So we have regular meetings, and the benefit is that I can talk to people who, like Marshall, treats breast cancer patients, explains to me what the issue is. We can discuss approaches that we need to do in research, and we can discuss it within researchers with different expertise. So my expertise or my research is focusing, as Afshin already mentioned, on breast cancer metastasis, because this is a big, big problem, as you may know. The initial cancer may be diagnosed, it may be surgically removed, there may have been chemotherapy, and then there is a big waiting time. And this big waiting time is when you don't know whether or not this cancer is coming back. And everyone is afraid of that fact. And the question is, how can we understand what's happening? And if we have talked about 50 years of breast cancer research, you have to imagine that in the beginning, there was a breast cancer. That was all that was diagnosed. And it was different than colon cancer and different than other cancers. Now we know a lot more about breast cancer. It's not the breast cancer. And this is what Marshall has already alluded on. We have to be very differentiated in how we characterize that breast cancer. So how can we treat this breast cancer? And we know now that one breast cancer is different the other breast cancers. Some of them are hormone receptor positive and they are differently treated. Others are from the beginning hormone receptor negative, and this therapy that is called endocrine therapy will not work there. And you have probably heard about triple negative breast cancers or basal type breast cancers. These are breast cancers that do not respond. They are kind of aggressively growing much more than other cancers. And we have to understand what is the cellular physiology of those breast cancers. So research has been put into breast cancer. We have identified and realized that it is not only one cell type that makes up the cancer. There's so-called cancer stem cells, and there are so-called mature stem cancer cells, and they react differently. And some of our therapeutic approaches kill cancer cells that are fast proliferating. But the other cancer cells do not do that, and they wait, and they wait their term, and then they proliferate and start out, and they haven't been responding from the beginning to this therapy. We just haven't known, because we have no means of detecting it, because it's a small number of cells, and these cells suddenly see the opportunity and they grow. And so the question that we have, what makes cancer cells move, first of all, regrow, and secondly, move to another place. So your breast cancer is not coming back in the breast, it's coming back in the lungs, it's coming back in bone, it's coming back in the brain. And this is where my research also comes together, because I'm also involved with brain cancer and there is some similarities. So the question is, why do they move and what mechanisms do they have? And we have to understand what cancer cells do, how do they survive, how do they move from one place to the other, so they can change their phenotype. From sitting in one spot, they can suddenly migrate. And they can migrate through the tissue, then they end up in lymph tissues and lymph nodes, or they can migrate and enter the bloodstream, for example. And then they become circulating tumor cells. And these circulating tumor cells can get anywhere in the body. But they don't make cancers anywhere in the body. So again, the question is, how do they choose where they make a metastasis? This is not clear at all, and people are still researching this. And so they send out signals, and these signals change the environment in the organ these breast cancers will be residing eventually. Or there's another very true and proven fact that some breast cancer cells are different than others, and they are more likely to go and reside in the lung, for example. Others are primarily managing to go in the brain. And so this is what they do, and then they can sit there for years. They don't do anything, they survive, they're not dead, and these cells are called dormant or sleeping cells. And these are very dangerous because we don't see them right away. And they may at one point come back and they decide to proliferate. And so my research is partially looking at the signals from that microenvironment, as we call it, so the signals from the other cells around them. Because cancer cells have receptors, hormone receptors, other receptors, growth factor receptors. They are like mailboxes, so like eyes and ears to the environment. And so they listen to signals from the environmental cells. And we need to understand more of not only the receptors, but also to what signals are coming in these different cells. And what does it do in these cancer cells? And I'm also looking at, and this is what Afshin is researching on, the beginning of the cancer, and I'm looking at a stem cell molecule that is expressed in our normal body stem cells during development and in body stem cells in the adulthood. But cancer cells, they express and re-express this molecule. It must be very important for them, because from all the screening analysis, we know that patients who have that stem cell molecule have a poorer prognosis than others who don't have that. So this is my research topic, that molecule is called HMGA2. So this is a nuclear protein, so it resides in the nucleus of the cell, which is kind of the brain of the cell. This is where your DNA is, this is where your DNA changes are, this is where there is the decision of which proteins are being expressed in the cells. And the proteins are the executive branch, yeah? The DNA is more or less what is genetic information that we have in all the cells, but the protein is really the executive branch, and what do we actually do and how do we do that. And so this molecule that I'm working on is changing it. And we have also learned that it increases the resistance to chemotherapy. So we have cancer cells that die when they're being treated with chemo, and others that don't. And so this molecule, for example, helps in repairing the damage that the chemotherapy does to help the cells survive so they don't die. And the tricky part that we face with treatment, when we look at it from a biology point of view, is that cancer cells are our own body cells. They are not different. It's different than if we have an intruder, a bacterium, or some strange cells, and our immune system is crazy, because this is something foreign that we want to throw off, and we have means to do that. But cancer cells, they can hide. They can treat and trick out our immune system, because they have the same proteins than other cells in our body. They don't have foreign proteins, and this makes it so difficult. Our body has checks and balances, so if you have a mutation in a normal cell that is dangerous for the body, usually these cells die. It's called an apoptotic mechanism. So they die because there is a check mechanism in the cells. Cancer cells have mutations. They may not die, they may live with those mutations. And so these cancer cells can also develop different traits. They can change. And this is what makes metastasis so tricky to study, because it is not there's A and there's B and there's C. There is A, B, and C already to a certain extent in the beginning. and then they develop in different directions. You may treat the type C cells, you may not treat the type B cells, and they may just take longer, and they may choose a different niche than other cells. So basically, my research is in collaboration with other researchers, and you have mentioned Sabine Mai. Sabine Mai is also a Sabine, and she is working in cancer care, and I collaborate with her, so we know each other very well, and she's looking at the genomic side as the telomeric side. I'm looking at the protein side and the chemoresistance side. So this is where we come together and of course work together, because our molecule is also preserving the telomeres. And as you may have known and learned about telomeres, they are the cells that determine how long a cell can live. These are the chromosomal ends that are kind of the time ticking, the clock ticking of a life of a cell. So the molecule that I'm working in is basically helping to maintain these telomeres, and it is helping in repairing the damage that the chemotherapy does to a genome in the cell, and it helps providing a phenotype that makes cells more migrant. So instead of sitting tucked in, they actively develop mechanisms to migrate in the bloodstream or through a barrier or through a tissue. So our research is looking into what can we find out. How does the cell do that? How is this molecule regulated? How does the cell respond to environmental signals from a foreign organ like a lung or a brain? And what can we learn from there to help find mechanisms that we can stop this growth of the cell? So that is, in a nutshell, what we are doing.
I'm just picking the microphone. Obviously, we have to start.
Okay.
But you have one more minute.
Okay, I have one more minute. Okay. So, as an example, because I said I was working on triple-negative breast cancer cells, some of those have BRCA mutations. You may have heard of those mutations. These are genetic mutations that make you more susceptible to breast cancer. And there is a therapy out there that is in clinical trials with so-called PARP inhibitors, and olaparib is one that is in the trial. And some patients respond very well to this treatment, because if the genetic mutations is there, they respond very well and the cancer cells die. But still there are some patients, again, individual people, who don't react to this PARP inhibitor treatment so well. So we have looked at it with breast cancer cells that we have isolated from patients or that are available as cell lines, and we've realized that this molecule that is that we are working on, this AGENT-GA2, is inhibiting PARP inhibitors. It doesn't really, so basically it prevents their full action, meaning that the cells do not die. They cannot only repair better their DNA damage, they can also sense it better, they can recruit energy resources better than the other cells who don't have AGENT-GA2, so our stem cell molecule. And they also prevent the PARP that is inhibited by PARP inhibitor from getting trapped at the DNA. So this is one of the reasons why the cancer cells die. This is a reason for PARP inhibitors to be successful if this molecule isn't there. So again, we found something additional that explains why in certain people this treatment that works very well in others does not work. So I think we need more of this research to understand why therapy is successful in some and not so successful in other patients.
Said 1 minute. So.
Okay.
Thank you to our panelists. What a wonderful way of describing what you're doing. Now I can get to do two housekeeping items. Number one, you probably notice you have these little forms that tell us how well we did. So we'd appreciate you guys tell us how wonderfully we're doing tonight. And if you have other opinions, then it's just a piece of paper. Don't bother with it. But if you're, no, I'm just kidding, of course. Please fill those out so we know how we can improve this. We want to do better. And the second thing is, now we have a task for you guys. You have to ask questions. If you stump the panel to the point where they have to Google the answer for your question, you get to have more of these stuff, which is great. No, but anyway, this is the part where you guys ask the panelists questions and they'll answer them for you. Otherwise, I'll have to start asking questions.
Well, why is ultrasound not an effective way of detecting tumors?
I presume that's directed at myself. Ultrasound is actually used as one of the adjuvant methods of trying to detect breast cancer. However, ultrasound on its own typically doesn't have the resolution that allows you to detect small lesions. And that's really the fundamental reason why it's not a primary screening mechanism.
Is it the wavelength?
Sorry?
The wavelength?
The wavelength is a lot longer, yes. So ultrasound is you know, very much in the low frequency range, it's just high frequency sound, whereas microwaves is somewhat higher frequencies than that, and x-rays are even higher than that. So that's why x-rays fundamentally have a much better resolution than anything else that we can throw at this problem. But it does have downsides.
Yeah. I got another question. What is it that causes a dormant malignant cell to become virulent? Is it a further mutation or is it epigenetic?
That's a very good question. It's probably a combination, or it can be both for sure. And the epigenetic part is the reaction to the environment, because the environment with the signals that it sends and the cell, the way it reacts to this, can do exactly epigenetic changes. So these are changes that modify our genes without being genomic changes, yeah, absolutely correctly. And this can happen. Both of it is possible, yes. Yes.
Is everyone comfortable with epigenetic changes?
So you have genetic changes, which means true changes in the genome of each cell. And the epigenetic changes, you don't have to change in the genome itself, but it is the way your gene is repressed or it is activated. That can, you still have both genes, yeah, or you have still both situations, but environmental situations drive cell signaling, and the cell signaling sends a signal to the nucleus and says, now this gene is repressed or this gene is activated. And this is not a permanent position, yeah, that can be reversed at one point if other signals are there. So you have changes in the cell. So a gene that was quiescent, for example, meaning that wasn't expressed, there was no protein transcribed from this gene, can suddenly be activated because there is a signal coming from the environment binding to one of the receptors. The receptor senses this, signals into the nucleus, so the brain of the cell, and says, now we need to activate that gene because it helps me as a cell to proliferate or to feel at home in this environment. And each organ has a different structure of the tissue. And when you think of breast tissue, that is very different than brain tissue or lung tissue. And you have very different cells. So for a cancer cell to just go there and feel at home, it's probably not a given. So there is a certain pre-selection from the, we call it a heterogeneity of the cancer, knowing that not all the cells are the same. Some of the cells are fine with the other environment, others aren't, and they would never survive. And then they come in this environment and then they face a totally different neighborhood, like when you move somewhere. And you either like your neighborhood or you don't like, or the neighbors talk to you suddenly and that changes you. Yeah, and suddenly you feel okay in that neighborhood. You go out and then this may create epigenetic changes that allow those cells to thrive and to proliferate and to change to a certain extent so they can feel well in this new environment, which is a different organ. And then they form a metastasis or so-called distant tumor. And this tumor often is very different. This is again something we didn't know 50 years ago. Yeah? We thought it is the same breast tumor. It has originally come from the same breast tumor. But when you look at the tumor that formed in the lung or in the brain or in the bone, it is different. It has different genes activated. It has different proteins that are active. It looks different, has different receptors. So that took us a while to understand. And this is the reason why we can never treat a metastatic tumor the same way as we could treat a primary tumor, because it is a different reaction. And it has learned to cope with chemotherapy. It has activated, for example, DNA repair mechanism that the primary tumor didn't know about, yeah, and didn't have active. So these are some of the reasons that explain why the treatment of metastatic tumors is much more tricky than a primary tumor.
know all the research that you've done. Do you know what specific carcinogenic agents promote cancer? For example, I came from northern Manitoba mining town. And from the time I was born there, and by the time I left, we had a smelter. And this smelter gave off very toxic, whatever you want to call it, sulfur dioxide, arsenic, cadmium, and so on. I have to tell you that in my town, and over the years, the number of women who have developed breast cancer. And I'm just wondering, does that promote like estrogen activity? I mean, is it the air pollution that causes that? I mean, do you know of specifics at all over the years of your research that you deal with directly?
I just wanted to say you may not be able to directly comment on the specifics of what you asked. But what you asked about carcinogenic agents that are known, I think...
There are carcinogenic agents known, yes, for different types of cancer. But again, they do not cause cancer in every person. Yeah? It is not that simple that if you have a carcinogen there, then this cancer will develop. But there are, of course, agents that are substances that are capable of changing your genome. And these are potentially capable of creating a cancer. Because if you have genome changes, you may change your tumor suppressor genes, yeah, that suppress the activity of a cell that may develop a tumor in terms of proliferation or DNA damage checkpoints. But it doesn't necessarily have to be there. And again, there comes in an individual predisposition because we are all different. We all have different genetic risk factors that we bring with us. And this in combination with the external factors that potentially can cause cancer, but don't have to in every person, increases your risk but doesn't predict whether you as an individual will develop cancer.
Shock you to learn that some of those very agents are what we use in the laboratories to turn normal cells into cancer. But we don't tell our graduate students that until they sign on their contracts. Then we tell them what they're going to be using in the lab. Yeah, it's a little trick we've learned. This is all being recorded. I shouldn't have said that.
I was just wondering, is there any way to test for the dormant cancer cells that you were talking about? And if not, would there be any benefit from trying to provoke the cells, or would that be more detrimental?
It's a very good question. It would be great if you could see and find these dormant cancer cells. The problem is already when you think of imaging, you need millions of cells, yeah? Correct me if I'm wrong, to see a nodule that is suspicious in imaging. Dormant cells is one or two cells somewhere. It's like finding a needle in a haystack, and there is no way to image those cells as single cells. Trying to provoke those cells would mean that you would stimulate them to grow, basically, to do something. And this is a dangerous thing, as you correctly said, because if you don't have, at the same time, the means to keep them quiet again, or eradicate those cells that you don't want to have, then you basically have provoked something that would have otherwise happened maybe 10 years from now or not at all, because you don't know whether or not it happens. It's not hard to predict. So unless we find something else, and people are working on this to find, to understand more what these cancer cells are and how do they differ from normal cells? So they, for sure, and we are partially working on this, they activate cellular stress mechanisms because they have stress in that new environment and they need to survive. So they need to do something different. And so if we can find a way in the future to have very sensitive mechanisms that they would take up, and we would find, because it would be amplified, that signal, that these cancer cells have stress, or a different metabolic pathway, and we need an amplifier for this, then we would have a chance. And but we need to understand more what they do, what exact mechanisms these are, and what are, how are they different from the surrounding cells, because this is key. That is the noise to specific signal ratio that you have in these cases.
Thank you.
Don't poke the bear sometimes.
Dr. Pistorius, I'm wondering if you could expand on your suitcase-sized invention, if I can call it that. What's the goal of price per unit and the goal size?
Well, as I said, our ultimate goal size is to get this down to a really portable system, something that is easy to move around, take out into rural communities, and you know, my vision ultimately would be something that is as portable as a cell phone. The cost, again, the cost would be ideally something that is affordable to rural communities, which is, you know, orders of, you know, tens of thousands of dollars rather than hundreds of thousands of dollars. You know, even governments in developing countries struggle to find money for healthcare, and so, you know, as low as possible would be our goal. And the nice thing about microwave-based imaging is that the costs, thanks to the cell phones, are coming down. You know, 10 years ago, microwave components were quite expensive. 20 years ago, they were quite expensive. And because of the mass production of cell phones, all of these components are becoming cheaper and cheaper. And so that helps us in bringing overall the cost of our system down in a marketable type way. At the moment, of course, we're using quite expensive components, and so our system is not 10,000, quite a lot more than that, unfortunately, and it's still much larger than I would like. But we are trying to use, for example, you know, sophisticated solid-state detectors to allow us to detect the microwaves, rather than conventional antennas, which helps us reduce the size again of the system and reduces cost as well.
Thank you.
With hormone-related cancers, I'm just wondering, for women who are on the drugs, I tend to do lots of reading. So I've been hearing lately that sometimes these drugs stop working for certain women and not others. I'm wondering, like, what kind of tests are done to ensure that if you're on the drug that it's actually still working for you? I'm also wondering one other thing, if you bear with me. Oncotype testing, do we have that here? And do you do that before you put someone on the drug? Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for the question. Great question. So, for your first question, you're right. So, I mentioned that about 80% of breast cancers express the hormone receptor, and so we treat about 80% of patients with hormonal-based treatments. So, the different agents are all used for different things, but so tamoxifen and a group of drugs called aromatase inhibitors, letrozole, estrazole, simvastatin, and then there are some newer ones, one that's an injectable called fulvestrant. So they're used in different circumstances. Most of the women who are on them to try to prevent the cancer from coming back. That's probably what you're referring to. The situation is when it's been cut out and when you've done everything and there's no evidence that there's cancer remaining, but trying to prevent one of those dormant cells from growing again. So we use those drugs for many years, and we'll typically now recommend that women take them for 10 years. And that's because we know that reduces their risk long-term of having that cancer come back. The benefits of those drugs carry over, and so we know that the risk actually continues to be lower for women even at year 15 after they've stopped at year 10. So that's how we use them. There are a number of reasons why it stops working, and the challenge is really figuring out which ones, why that is, and which women, one mechanism, you know, might drive that cancer from growing again, or why it might be different in a different woman. And there's no, as Sabine was saying, there's really no way at the moment to know why one might start growing or another one wouldn't start growing. We, you know, something occurs that allows it to either grow without the estrogen pathway. So one of the, I think, commonest reasons would be that cancer is no longer sensitive, or that spot of cancer that may have come back is no longer sensitive to that drug. It's found another growth pathway and it's not dependent on estrogens anymore. That's probably the most common. One of the newer drugs that's out tries to prevent that. So how a cancer cell might continue to grow despite stopping that growth pathway. There's a new drug, a couple of new drugs that are out that inhibit that cycling and the ability for them to grow. So it's the intent is that it tries to catch the ones that maybe aren't growing as quickly and actually just stop them completely, because the more that they grow, the more chance they have to continue to grow and then spread. So those drugs are, examples are palbociclib and ribociclib, and so those are now starting to be shown to be beneficial in addition to the hormonal agents. And I think that's, at least therapeutically, when we try to offer treatments, that's where a lot of the work is going. So trying to say, well, if they are going to find a way around, for whatever reason, then what could we add to it to stop that? Because there's, at least I'm not aware of a way yet to predict what's caused that change or how to prevent that change from occurring. I don't know if you have any.
Maybe one comment that I would like to do is when you think about treatment, combination therapy is coming more and more now, where people think, okay, cancer cells have so many ways to evade therapy, and it's not only that they just retract by epigenetic changes, they may not make their hormone receptor anymore. So they're out of the equation, yeah? They just don't produce it anymore. So your endocrine therapy will not work because they have just shut it down. And they have gotten used to other hormone receptors and other growth factors that they say, okay, maybe I can grow this way, yeah? And then they find a different way. And they also have mechanisms as a cell. When usually a drug is taken up into the cell to be able to act in that cell, they have mechanisms to throw it out again. So at the cell membrane, which is the outer wall of the house basically, they have kind of a revolving mechanism, like a revolving door. The drug comes in and the revolving door throws it out again. Yeah, and they can crank up these pumps. Yeah, they're called efflux pumps. So this is another mechanism where the same drug that you have just used before suddenly isn't working anymore because the concentration within the cell is not high enough anymore. And that tells us what these cells, these are all, we are talking about biology. It's not something that's scripted in stone. This is biology, so the cell is reacting, and this is what our body cells do normally, and this is why our bodies are so resilient to so many other situations, yeah? Because these cells are capable of adapting and adjusting, and cancer cells are much more so, unfortunately, yeah? And they find this much more, in a much more complicated setting, they grow faster, they have more genomic changes that they can try out which one works. And so that makes it...
Right, because there may be, as you said, millions of cancer cells. It just takes one to find a way around that treatment that you've got to then continue to grow and cause trouble. So your second question about Oncotype DX is a good one. So Oncotype DX is a special test that's done by a company that essentially measures a number of genes, 21 different genes within the cancer, within the tumor. So they take a sample of the tumor, you send it to this company, and they measure quantitatively how much of those genes are expressing. And then they put that into a mathematical formula and determine a risk score. There are a handful of other scoring systems out there that do similar things now, but Oncotype DX is the one that seems to be most common in North America. And its use right now is really for women who have what looks like has some potentially low-risk features, and you want to know if it actually has some high-risk features where the patient really should receive more aggressive treatment. And so it's used to help further risk stratify. I talked about what the cancer looks like under the microscope as a way to measure that aggressiveness, the different markers like estrogen receptors and HER2 proteins. And so Oncotype DX, or any of these recurrent scores, is one of those. So the simple answer to your question is it's available but not funded. So it's available. The company will happily take money to do the test. We don't have access to funding for it at the moment. Yep.
Wait for the mic then. Other people want to hear you too.
Okay.
It was a quick follow-up.
It is a quick follow-up. So for people taking like AIs or tamoxifen, should their estrogen levels like be tested from time to time?
Oh, I see. Yeah, that was part of your question.
That was my question. Yeah.
So, no, there's no evidence that that's helpful, actually.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. So it's right. It's a great question. We know that there are certain other medications that you might take that change how much tamoxifen's being metabolized. It changes it so that it doesn't maybe work as well. And there are some studies that show that that might increase risk, and some that don't, that show that it doesn't really increase that risk. And so we don't actually know whether there's any benefit to testing estrogens and monitoring that closely. There are certain situations where it's different, but for the most part, there's certainly no evidence that we should be doing that, and so that's the challenge.
I think I have a question over here, and then I'll come to you.
Hi there. To the gentleman in the middle. So is there a future where compression is no longer necessary for X-ray mammography?
Thank you for my student.
I'm not giving you this money back.
He's doing it to remind me of the fact that I didn't mention that microwave imaging gets away without having to do breast compression. And that's something that I didn't mention, which is one of the reasons why it seems to be quite popular among women at the moment as far as the process. And so yes, there is a future. It's not that far away, hopefully. Where something like microwave-based breast imaging would be able to generate images of the breast, or at least identify and detect tumors within the breast without having to do breast compression. And that's largely driven by the fact that we don't have the radiation risks associated with that we have with X-rays, where we need to compress the breast to get the dose low, and also to reduce the scattering in X-ray mammography. So thank you, that's a good point.
And
so
that would do it.
The ideal world would be where we would be able to take your cell phone, have an extremely sensitive GPS type system, and its gimbal orientation, know exactly where it is. It can emit microwaves, it can detect microwaves, it has a small computer on board, and maybe we could even do something, but not for the next decade.
Hey, question here.
I see that the orientation is very much towards finding a solution in one direction or treating one type of cancer or the other. But questions here, maybe the solution is not possible to be treated. I mean, we cannot find this, what you're looking for, right? But is there a strategy that you're developing? Is there a department of strategy of applying cancer? Or different procedures at different time?
That's a great question. I don't know. Maybe I'll start anyways. The way that these novel treatments are studied, the way that people attack a problem is not as coordinated as we'd like, that's for sure. There are large groups that coordinate their own efforts, and so there are at Cancer Care, at the Research Institute, we have gone through strategic exercises to make sure that we are focusing our efforts in certain places, and other organizations do that. But is the scientific community focused on really driving through strategically what the next discovery should be, or where they really should focus their efforts? Not as much as you might think. I think a lot of it is more discovery-based. So people find something and that attracts attention if it seems like a valuable advance, and then that field grows. An area that's got a lot of attention lately, for example, is immuno-oncology, or using the immune system to treat a cancer. And certainly it's got a lot of promise, and there's a lot of novel treatments out in that area. And it's a good example of how, if you look 10 years ago, there were some very small examples of where that treatment was being used. I wouldn't say that was something that the scientific community strategically said, this is where we need to go. It's really the immune system is where we need to go. But they showed some progress, and many more people started to work on it. And so now we have many more treatments that are available. I think part of it too is the funding, is funding dependent. So the strategy that goes forward just really depends on the organization that wants to provide the funding for that. They're the ones who help to determine where. So CIHR, for example, or the Cancer from Manitoba Foundation, determine what specifically they are looking for in projects.
I was thinking that the direction of research should be actually changing the conditions of this occurrence rather than finding the end of them, because we are not perfect as humans.
Yeah, prevention research.
So our research cannot be perfect, but by changing the conditions, we can go somewhere else.
My question is, how is there any way to know whether chemotherapy is actually working? And if it isn't working, what would be the next steps?
So that's a very good question. So it's, as you can imagine, we've got a few answers. So there are situations where we're able to measure the disease, on a CT scan. You can measure a spot in an organ, or a few spots, or what have you, and you can follow that. And if you give someone a treatment and that shrinks, then that obviously feels better, and you've done something to shrink that tumor. If it doesn't grow, should be just as happy. I certainly don't always expect for it to shrink. If there are new spots or if it grows, then of course you're worried that it's not working. And in reality, it's actually more complicated than that. These spots that we're seeing can come and go for various reasons. There are some treatments that we use that actually make these spots more visible to some of the tests that we use. So a good example is a bone scan. If we use a treatment that treats a spot within the bone, the bone scan often will get brighter, and that's sometimes worrisome. You can see it in more spots than you did before, but that's what you're actually hoping for, is that there's a treatment effect. And it's hard to tease those out. It's definitely hard to tease those out. The more common situation where I get that asked is in someone who doesn't have anything measurable. So where I'm seeing them because they've had surgery for their breast cancer and there's nothing for us to measure. And I'm telling them, they've already had it removed. I'm telling them that they've got this chance that the cancer is going to come back without treatment, and that with treatment it can be lower. And often at the end of that, they go through all this treatment, I get asked, did it work? Did it do what we wanted it to do? And what people I think really want to know is, was it there and is it gone? And that's a question that I can't answer. And as we heard earlier, we can't detect those microscopic, one or two dormant cells that might be somewhere. But the goal of chemotherapy in that situation, so-called adjuvant chemotherapy, is to reduce the risk of the cancer coming back. And so we know that if we had 100 women with the same type of breast cancer and we gave them chemotherapy, or we gave half of them chemotherapy, we know that after chemotherapy, after that treatment, more of them would be alive, or more of them would be cancer-free for longer because of the chemotherapy, if that's the only variable that's different. So in the clinical trial world, that's what happens. When they started, the ones that I talked about initially in the 70s, they had hundreds of women, and typically these clinical trials will have thousands of women in them now, and they will have basically the same characteristics, and they will randomly assign them to one treatment or another. So now it's standard of care, whatever that means for that patient, plus something, typically, that's typically what it is, and they look to see at the end of the day if the group that got that extra something did better. And you measure that various ways, but, you know, basically it's the percentage of people that don't have it come back at a certain time. That's, you know, one common measurement. But it's, on an individual level, not something that we know. You can't, we can't measure that. And that's where it gets really difficult. So the group that I want my patients to be in, if they need it, is the group that got the treatment, or at least is in the lowest risk. And I see that as one of my big goals, is to try to get patients into the lowest risk situation that they can be in. And for some, that's chemotherapy. I don't know, does that answer your question?
Partially, yes.
I was just wondering if there were any blood tests or anything like that that are available. So there aren't, I mean there are definitely ones that are available, there aren't any that are recommended. So right now there have been for many years known these proteins in your blood that you can measure, called tumor markers, and in certain situations they're useful. They can go up, you know, up and down depending on the disease course. They have not been shown to be beneficial in the setting where the cancer has been completely removed and you're following someone along. So in fact, the American Society of Clinical Oncology, the North American largest group of oncology providers and researchers, has put out position statements and continues to do so, that that shouldn't be done. We shouldn't test those because they're often not helpful. They are either falsely elevated, and so you go through all sorts of tests, or they're falsely negative and don't go up, and you don't actually pick things up sooner. What people are doing, though, is trying to develop ways to detect whether there's any cancer remaining using blood tests. And so one of those methods is looking for circulating tumor cells. And so there's a lot of different techniques out there for taking blood samples at various time points and measuring whether you can actually find cancer cells that are in the blood, literally circulating in the blood, or even just DNA, components of the genome from that cancer cell. And so that's an area of research, definitely. At the clinic, unfortunately, we don't have a test that's reliable enough. So there are some available, and there are private labs that will do them, private research groups, really. But they have not been shown to be helpful to predict what you want. You know?
So the second part of my question was, if you have determined by maybe a CT scan or something that the cancer cells are not decreasing or they're increasing, what would be the next steps then in that case?
It depends. I must say, in the situation where breast cancer is in other organs and you're following what's going on in those organs,
like in a lymph node, for example.
In a lymph node, yeah. So. It really depends on the situation. Breast cancer is very complicated in the way that it can grow and cause trouble and be unpredictable sometimes. So if something's growing just in a lymph node and nowhere else, then often we'll try to address treatment at that lymph node. Usually, though, there's other places where things are changing, and so we end up either changing the treatment completely, because, as you can imagine, there are certain organs or certain places in the body where we're more concerned if a cancer grows. And so if that spot grows even a little bit, but the rest are okay, I'm going to be more worried about that spot and want to change treatment, kind of. So it's usually either adding something or switching to something. Hard to know. You know, specific circumstances are pretty individualized.
Question over here.
Are there any evidence to suggest that persons who do breast implants are at increased risk of developing breast cancer?
That's a great question. I'm not sure if that's for me. No, there's no evidence that there's an increased risk of breast cancer. They are more difficult to screen. And so that is, they are not included in the screening program. Mammography is not terribly helpful. I'm sure there's a very complicated reason why. But they're not as compressible, certainly, but the tissue is very much more distorted. And so there are some elevated risks, but although not, at least that I'm aware of, directly related to there being an implant there.
So maybe I'll take the chair's prerogative and ask you a question that you may have to Google. Then I get to have a cookie. So 50 years of research, that's what we've come and heard. And you guys still telling us we need more? Seriously? I'm not going to do research for 50 years. I'll be 94 by then. I just give up my age. Okay, besides those points, what does the panel think are the areas where the next major breakthroughs in cancer therapy diagnosis is going to come from? I get to have a cookie.
We haven't Googled yet.
Do you need my phone? It's here, just in case.
Okay, perhaps I'll just comment on the imaging side of things. I mean, certainly, as I said at the outset of my introduction, X-rays have been with us for over 100 years. Do I anticipate that we're going to be using them 50 years from now? I would probably answer no. They're useful and they've proved valuable for many years, but they have risks that we would like to eliminate. And they're not as sensitive as we would like, they're not as specific as we would like, and so I'm sure there are going to be other better molecular-based markers and systems that we're going to have in our armamental of tools that we will be using.
So it's a difficult question to answer.
No, it's a difficult question. I mean, we have to visualize what's going to happen, but X-rays have been with us for a long time, and so I can't just sort of dismiss them overnight and say they have no value. But I would certainly hope that I'm not going to be doing research in 50 years' time, I can tell you that, but certainly I would hope that my students are working on something novel and exciting. Much the same way 30 or 40 years ago, we had no idea that we would yet be able to use resonance imaging, magnetic resonance, to create images of patients. It was purely a physical-based mode which we could take the samples and do some interesting experiments on. But nobody had any ideas that it was going to turn into an imaging modality. And the same is true for CT. And so we've seen lots of Nobel Prizes for these sorts of ideas where we've taken fundamental physics concepts and turned them into something that's valuable to society as far as imaging is concerned. And I certainly hope that will continue.
And there you said, without telling us when you're going to retire. Because I already started that, but I'm sorry. No. So maybe a cell biologist perspective on.
Yeah, you've probably heard about personalized medicine, and this is also going on for cancer, of course, for breast cancer and other cancer. And the idea is that we now know about everyone reacts differently to treatment. The idea that there's out there is that you take a tumor that is in the patient and you do new sequencing techniques and you learn as much as possible of the genomic background of this particular tumor. And then you go at the same time and try with the help of bioinformatics to find what is already out there in the pool of treatments and the pool of medications that may work for this patient. And then you try and test it. This is ongoing right now. Do I know whether this will be successful, whether this will be bringing a benefit to these patients, whether this would really help? I'm thinking of the changes the cancer does when it sits in a different niche, in a different organ. Would I be able to predict this and then design a therapy that tells me this won't go there? I don't know. Yeah, so maybe we need to also see it from different angles, and this is what researchers do. Some think we need to go this route, others think we need to find a common ground for different cancers to go in the lung. Why do breast cancer go in the lung? Why does breast cancer go to the brain? Why does melanoma go to the brain? Why does colon cancer not go to the brain? Is there a reason maybe that the brain tells them in terms of signals and you can come from another direction? We don't know which way is right. And I think it's worth pursuing all these pathways to find out more. And unfortunately, we are not there yet. And we try a lot of things, we do a lot of expensive analysis, we try them in cells in the dish. The next step is the mouse experiments, and a lot of things that have worked in the mouse have not proven to be valid in human beings. So this is again another step, and you cannot experiment with humans, you try not to do that. You try to get as much information, but still in the end,
you need to test out what works best with what is available right now. If I'm a patient right now, I need to see what's out there right now. And I cannot wait for what will be out there in 10 or 20 years. And I think we cannot just say this is the direction right and this is the direction wrong, because we don't know.
Sure, thank you. So, yeah, I would say it's, of course, really very difficult to predict where things are going to go. There are already a lot of very novel approaches to treating cancer, not specifically breast cancer, and I've mentioned a few of those. You know, one of those is immuno-oncology, so to speak, where people are trying to either activate the immune system in a very controlled way to fight the cancer. There are really interesting, you may have heard recently in the news, a very expensive medication that was approved by the FDA with actually a very small study called CAR-T therapy that essentially looks at a very personalized therapy and modifying the genome so that the treatment can be more effective. I don't know if that's going to be effective for many forms of cancer. I think truly we are just scratching the surface as to how complicated these cancers are, and you know, speaking specifically about breast cancer, you know, we talk about a few subgroups and that are all kind of treated in a similar manner. And I think over the next decades, we will refine that more. Whether that's called personalized medicine or not, I'm not sure. I expect that we will figure out the answer to your question, which is, if you use this treatment on the cancer, what happens? How does it grow? What then starts up, and can we predict that, or can we target that before it starts, or can we at least measure that afterwards? So we might be using one treatment and very reliably know that another pathway that we have a different drug for will be activated. That's probably where things will become more personalized, where you can say, well, I hope anyways that we'll be able to identify what that mechanism is, identify treatments that then you can either add on or switch someone to. It's hard to know actually where that's going to go. I think I hope that we're able to, for example, detect that better in an individual, because I think we're, again, just, it's a very rudimentary understanding when you're just looking at a CT scan and looking at the size of something. What it would be great to see is, well, the size didn't change, but 10% of that cancer is active, and that's the 10% you need to be worried about. And it's active with this pathway, and if you still used what you were using and added this one thing, you would stop that 10%. And it may be that that you start to slowly develop treatments for each one of those circumstances. But exactly where we'll be, I think,
so to sum up, no cookies for me. I think we'll come to our final question, as it is 8:30.
I was just wondering if any jurisdictions in Canada or Europe or US have abandoned routine mammography screening for the elder women, and if there's any plans to modify the program here in Manitoba.
Good question.
You guys can share this one.
So I'm not aware of any that have you know, directly modified that. The recommendation, the clinical trials that have been done with mammography have typically stopped at age 74 or 75. There's some work to look. So once someone's been diagnosed with a breast cancer and had treatment as part of their surveillance, we will typically recommend mammography as part of that as well. There's some work being done to sort out whether that's worthwhile for the rest of that person's life, or at a certain point it's not beneficial anymore. And so I think there are likely to be, you know, groups of patients where we do at least stop recommending it. I'm not aware of a plan to modify the program here at the moment. It's, you know, for women between ages 15 and 74, and it's every other year, and that's pretty consistent across the country, at least that's my understanding.
I really didn't have anything more to add.
Well, can you believe it? It's 8:30 already. I want to hear more. Love to hear these guys talk, but we're going to have to let them go. And I'm going to take exactly 1.5 minutes of your time to tell you something. So what basically you heard here today, or tonight, was that we stand on shoulders of giants that have worked in the past and showed us, you should look here, perhaps you should not look here. Do this is more beneficial. Like the pieces of a giant puzzle, where you look at one piece and you don't know where it goes until you get parts of the puzzle built and you realize, oh, that's where it goes. But someone discovered that piece, saw it earlier, just didn't know where it went in the bigger picture of Dunn's cancer. And that's why we need more. We need to find more pieces so we can put it together and create this picture that we all want. Perhaps it may not be that we're free of the disease, but we know how to manage it. And we know how to treat it properly without side effects. We do need more research. And it's a sad day where biomedical research has come under such scrutiny, where that we're being asked, where is your deliverable tomorrow? What do you have that I can sell to public? And what we are researchers. What I do, I'm a public servant. My research, her research, and their research is alike, is all publicly funded research. We create nothing to sell. We create information. The value of it may not be known today. It may be known tomorrow or a year from now. But we cannot know that until other pieces of the puzzle come together. And that's what will create groups. Because she sees something that I do not. You stand under the light shade and you cannot see beyond it because the eye, the light is in your eyes. But someone else looking afar sees something that you did not. And that's why we need to continue research. And this really saddens me to hear. For example, Manitoba Research Council just pulled back their competition for research dollars due to cutbacks. That is a sad day because now you can imagine how much research cannot be done in this province. Same story is true nationally. Even though the province, the federal government suggested funding research, not really, they're funding pockets of research, but it's not available nationally. This is a time perhaps we need to take a little bit of a break and think about this and realize, is it important to us to do more research? Do we need more basic foundational research or not? If that is the case, perhaps we should pick up the phone and call up our representatives, as we have, and make this point clear to them that it is important to us. Email will go a long way, a phone call will go a long way, because they are your public servants. They are there to represent your interests. And if this is important to you, then they have a job to do, and they need to represent you. With that, please fill out the forms. Let us know how we did. Enjoy the rest of the evening, and we'll stick around for more questions. Thank you, guys. Thank you.